fouled or whatever. Oh, in the eyes of Yokozuna. Hogan knocks Fuji down. Hogan looked close down. And down goes Yokozuna. Hogan, that's all.
Prime Minister, question number one, Mr. David Blunkett.
Question number one, Mr. Speaker.
Mr. Speaker, sir, this morning I presided at a meeting of the Cabinet and had meetings with ministerial colleagues and others. In addition to my duties in this House, I shall be having further meetings later today.
Mr. Blunkett.
Would the Prime Minister agree that in her speech to the National Children's Home, regarding the responsibility of fathers for the physical and financial well-being of their children living in a separate household, she understood she would strike a chord with many people who normally don't agree with her policies. And would she tell the House this afternoon why it is that amongst other policies which discriminate against fathers who try and take that responsibility, her government in 1988 introduced a budget which imposed income tax on payments made by fathers to their children in a way that helped to sustain them in a fashion that everyone in this House would wish to see.
Mr. Speaker, I'm grateful to the Honourable Gentleman for his comments about that speech, that fathers should take responsibility for children, particularly those illegitimate children, because they need the support. As he knows, there will be changes in taxation for married couples coming into force in the new budget. And I'll put the particular point to my right honourable friend, the Chancellor.
Sir Michael McNair-Wilson, number two.
I refer my honourable friend to the reply that I gave some moments ago.
Sir Michael McNair-Wilson.
After so many years of acrimonious dissent, doesn't my right honourable friend think it is rather optimistic to expect the Northern Ireland Party political leaders to reach some agreement over a devolved administration for their province? And instead, could I put it to her that the government should set up a review into the shape and structure of both regional and local government in Northern Ireland?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Could I remind her that it is exactly 20 years ago since Sir Patrick McCrory produced his report on the structure of local government in Northern Ireland, and could I suggest that a new review would be a timely contribution to any talks ahead of any talks that may take between any talks that may take place between the party political leaders?
Mr. Speaker, I think we would all wish to see greater involvement in local government in Northern Ireland of local government people, and we have considered it on many occasions and put it to the several parties. I don't think we could bring it in unless we have got the agreement of the different parties to proper devolved local government. We've not yet succeeded in doing so. My right honourable friend has asked the parties to come in and talk, and I'm sure that that will be one of the first things that he will wish to put to them.
Yeah, yeah. Mr. Neil Kinnock.
Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, the Prime Minister has made it clear this week that she was given seriously inaccurate information about the case of Mr. Colin Wallace, and that that incorrect information caused her to mislead the House. Will she therefore, as head of the security services, make a full statement to the House? And will she also commission a form of inquiry which has the power to ensure the full truth is told about the alleged efforts to discredit public figures and members of Parliament of several parties, including her own, and to subvert elected governments?
Yeah. Mr. Speaker, first, the statement which I made to the House on the 6th of May 1987 stands. It is not affected by the new information. It stands. Secondly, Mr. Wallace was a civil servant employed by the Ministry of Defence at the Army headquarters in Northern Ireland as an information officer. It seems right, therefore, that the statement was made by not by a minister at the Ministry of Defence on Tuesday, and was made by the Secretary of State for Northern Ireland today. The statement made by my honourable friend, the Member for the Armed Forces, indicated that there is an inquiry into Mr. Wallace's case before the Civil Service Appeal Board to be conducted by Mr. Colcock QC. There's also an inquiry in the Ministry of Defence as to how certain documents came to be overlooked.
Kellogg!
I'm sorry, Mr. Speaker, but that answer doesn't begin to address very basic questions. May I put it to the Prime Minister that the information which, in her words, has now come to light somewhat offsets the credibility of the statement she made in May 1987 that there was no evidence, I quote her, of misuse of information by any members of the security services, and that this fact alone surely justifies a full inquiry. Is the Prime Minister not aware that when the Wallace case raises serious issues of civil liberties and serious allegations of efforts to discredit members of Parliament and to undermine elected governments, it would be intolerable if she proposed to do absolutely nothing other than to hide behind anonymous civil servants?
I think that the Right Honourable Gentleman's assertions are correct. Insofar as new information came forth, and insofar as that had affected earlier statements, the details were given by my honourable friend, the Member for the Armed Forces, and set out in very considerable detail in his statement to the House. My own statement of the 6th of May 1987 was not affected by the new information. There was no, nor does the new information provide any evidence of attempts to undermine or discredit ministers. This is a matter of the presentation of Mr. Wallace's case to the Civil Service Appeal Board. That is being put correct, and insofar as the new information affected anything that ministers have said during this administration, we came straight to the House, a statement was made, and letters were written to people who otherwise might have had incorrect information, and the statement which was made to the House was, in accordance with tradition, shown to the former Ministers of Defence and Northern Ireland in the previous Labour administration, and their comments invited.
Mr. Speaker, isn't the Prime Minister aware that on both sides of this House and amongst wider interested parties, there is a strong opinion that the Colcott inquiry, for all its worth, and the internal inquiry in the Ministry of Defence, neither of them are broad enough or open enough to satisfy the public interest? And can the Prime Minister explain how it could be that she made a statement in May 1987 based honestly on the evidence that then existed? And by her own reckoning, new evidence, new details, new fact has now come to light. How can she claim, in the light of all those circumstances, that her statement then still stands and shouldn't be liable to any form of reconsideration or revision?
Because for the third time, Mr. Speaker, the new information does not provide any evidence to undermine the statement which I made to the House on the 6th of May 1987. It is of a much narrower kind than that, as was set out by my honourable friend, the Member for the Armed Forces, in his very detailed statement, which I commend to the Right Honourable Gentleman for detailed reading.
May I ask my Right Honourable friend, the Prime Minister, to recognise the seriousness of the description of the Leader of the Opposition about the events that are alleged to have taken place? And may I ask her, which government was in power when these events took place?
Mr. Speaker, the events referred to and the documents referred to events which took place in 1974 and 1975, a very, very long time ago, which is why this statement, which was made to the House by my honourable friend, the Member of the Armed Forces, was shown, of course, to the Right Honourable Gentleman, the Member for Leeds, South East and Morley, also to the noble Lords, Lord Mason, Lord Carrington and Lord Whitelaw. And their comments were invited. These are matters which occurred in 1975 or earlier.
Merlin Rees.
But can I put to the Prime Minister that the fact that the noble Lord Carrington and the noble Lord Whitelaw were brought into the consultations, and the fact that most of the documents that we have proving the case of what happened against many of us took place in 1971, 1972, and 1973. So it's no good saying it's just under a Labour government. And in that case, she was a member, a loyal member of the cabinet at that time. And so surely, it's not just a matter of a Labour government. It went on under both governments. Indeed, there is evidence that the Prime Minister of the day was maligned as well. So surely, what she said about the dirty tricks of right, it can't possibly cover what has now been revealed.
Mr. Speaker, may I once again refer the Right Honourable Gentleman to the statement which he saw and was made in very full detail. These events took place over about 15 years ago. There is nothing in the new information which was the cause of the statement to the House which casts doubt on my own statement of the 6th of May 1987, which is about the very much wider matters.
Yes, what's his name? Butterfowl!
Mr. Speaker, would my Right Honourable friend agree that the recruitment of more paramedically qualified staff to the ambulance services is needed to improve the service? Would she confirm that an offer has been made which will enhance that recruitment? And can she share my puzzlement that the union leaders seem to be opposed to it?
Mr. Speaker, in the ambulance service, particularly the accident and emergency part of the service, we need more people with the higher medical qualifications. At the moment, there are very few, and too few in our view, for the topmost efficiency of the service. That is why those people have been offered 16.3% increase in pay over an 18-month period. It is to attract those into the service which we wish to improve.
Alan Beath.
Honourable gentleman to reply, which I gave some moments ago.
Alan Beath.
Mr. Speaker, may I thank the Prime Minister that at least in her letter to the Treasury Select Committee, by way of its chairman, she expressed regret that in letters she had previously sent, there were errors as a result of the false information which she had been given. And now that she has expressed this personal regret and yet again has had to give account for things which happened before she took office as Prime Minister and for the fact that she had to relay to the House information which has proved not to be correct, will she not now think again, both about the need for a wider inquiry into the implications of this matter and to the accountability of the security services? Is it not the case that when ministers are not directly answerable to Parliament for things, those things are less adequately covered by civil servants' accountability to them?
Speaker, insofar as there had been statements made that were incorrect or which needed clarifying, we both came to the House and corrected those statements immediately. I think that is greatly to the government's credit, that as soon as the information was forthcoming, we made it. With regard to the security service, as the Right Honourable Gentleman is aware, there was a bill which set up both a commissioner and a tribunal. That was a great advance, and I do not think we need any further inquiries now.
Dr. Paisley.
Would the Right Honourable Lady not agree that this issue is far wider than the mere dismissal of Colin Wallace? Does she not know that in Northern Ireland at the Assembly, all the parties there called for a public sworn inquiry into the Kinkora scandal? And does she not realise that these things will not go away? And the time has come for a full, open and honest uncovering of these things so that people in Northern Ireland can know that this has come to an end. the dirty tricks that were carried on, and those at the receiving end surely have a right to have their say and put their case.
Mr. Speaker, the new information in the papers does not in any way substantiate Mr. Wallace's allegations in respect of the Kinkora boys' home. As the Honourable Gentleman is aware, there have been inquiries into that matter before, and the new information does not affect that. Nor does the new information provide any evidence of attempts to undermine or discredit ministers. And therefore my statement of the 6th of May stands.
Okay.
Number 4, sir.
The Honourable Gentleman's reply, which I gave some moments ago.
Mr. Speaker, there is growing support for the ambulance crews who are in dispute with their authorities and also the government itself. And the Prime Minister is getting more and more isolated in her stance. There is even greater concern now coming through that a harder line is being taken by management and some police authorities, to such an extent that in my constituency, an accident on Sunday night, the police crews were turned away by the police. The police crews were turned away by the police in favour of the Red Cross. I can't get an answer. What I need here is an assurance from the Prime Minister.
Shame!
I need an assurance.
The Honourable Gentleman, let's ask a question of the Prime Minister.
The question is this, Mr. Speaker. We want an assurance from the Prime Minister and her government that she is not giving instructions to the police or management to frustrate the work the ambulance men are trying to do in terms of accidents that are happening on our roads. We need that assurance now.
Mr. Speaker, the police have had to step in where the accident and emergency services were not operating properly, and we all wish they had been operating properly. With regard to the pay claim that has been made, with regard to the offer that has been made, I think many people will consider that an amount varying between 9% and 16.3%, the 16.3% of the more highly qualified, is a reasonable offer, and that one would expect people who deal with sick people and upon whom sick people to rely to return to their first duties.